Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Om Prakash. Would like to welcome everyone for this evening CME on steroids. We are going to cover antenatal and postnatal steroids. We are very fortunate today that we have an esteemed session moderator today, Dr. Sridhar Kalyan Sundaram. He has done MD Pediatrics and DM Neonatology from PGI Chandigarh. Further, he did his membership and CCT neonatology training in UK. Along with that, he has got his fellowship also from Royal College of Pediatrics and Childhood. He is presently working as a consultant neonatology and head of department at Zuleika Hospital, Dubai. He is also a president NNF Emirates and secretary IP neonatology chapter Emirates. So I will hand it over to him and then we'll start the session from there. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Om Prakash. Thank you for this opportunity, and I would like to thank a couple of hospitals in Navi Mumbai and the Chief Operating Officer, Mr. Santosh Marathe, for linking us up to provide this opportunity. I think it's a great idea to have a session on both antenatal steroids and postnatal steroids at the same time, because we have a combined audience of obstetricians and neonatologists and pediatricians, of course, and both are very important topics. And when obstetricians give us the babies, they don't know the full story that goes after the baby comes out. So it would be nice of them to know, and the complications we face with chronic lung disease and the postnatal steroids as well. Antenatal steroids, of course, is a very important topic. And for the past, since early 1980s, we should say, and since the late 1990s, we have definitely established it. Cochrane logo in the late 1980s was based on this, and I'm sure you'll be mentioning that as well. So I have great pleasure in introducing Dr. Vandana Gaudi, who is a senior obstetrician who has been working in the Navi Mumbai area for the past 30 years. So thank you so much for being here. And before I start the session, I would like to introduce you to the National Neonatology Forum Emirates branch, which is only 2 years old. And thanks to the previous Dr. Rishikesh Thackeray, Dr. VP Goswami, everyone was involved in initiating it and supporting us through this. We have been organizing a few sessions, and last month we had a webinar with Professor Satyan from UC Davis, California, which was a very successful meeting. And we also have the NNF India UAE Emirates Facebook page. And I would invite you to join us. And even this presentation, I'm hoping to have a copy of this on the YouTube channel we have created for the same. The aim is to progress with academics. I'm sure we'll have a very good academic session today. And over to you, Dr. Vandana. Please start the session with your lecture on antenatal steroids. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. And thank you, Dr. Om Prakash and Dr. Sridharan, for bringing me on this forum of pediatricians. I am working in Navi Mumbai as an obstetrician since the last 30 years. And right from the time when I was in my residency, corticosteroids were definitely used. So it gives me a lot of pleasure to talk a little bit about the use of corticosteroids. So I'm going to keep my presentation very short and going to give you just the bullet points of what are the recent recommendations based on so much of data on corticosteroid use. So we all know that it was first, though we've been using it for years together, we do know that Sir Graham Liggins and Ross Howey in the year 1972 actually published papers, the first use of the benefits of antenatal corticosteroids. And from then, for the first few years, there was a lag. People were not skeptical, it was not very popular. In the last 20, 25 years, the use of corticosteroids has really changed the scenario of how me as an obstetrician hands over the babies to my neonatologists. So how do the corticosteroids really act? Very briefly, they basically accelerate the development of type 1 and type 2 pneumocytes. And this leads to structural as well as biochemical changes. So when the volume of the lung increases, the mechanics of the lung becomes better, the lung becomes more compliant, so it is able to expand better. And the function of the lung also increases, whereby the gas exchange becomes easier when you have given your patient antenatal corticosteroid. What it also does is that it causes an induction of the beta cells, beta receptors in the lungs, and This plays a role in surfactant release and absorption of the alveolar fluid. Also, it increases the function and the development of enzymes which increase the phospholipids, and therefore the lung's maturity becomes faster than what it should be. So since there were so many controversies about corticosteroid use, recently in February 2019, the FIGO committee put up a committee of good clinical practice and gave some recommendations. And I'm going to really try and stick to these latest recommendations by the good clinical practice. And here they actually took a lot of data from almost 3,000 participants from 12 controlled trials. And they showed that corticosteroids actually reduce the occurrence of respiratory distress syndrome by overall 50% in the reduction in the ALDS, which is a very, very great use of a particular group of medications. And also neonatal morbidity and mortality goes down. And there is definitely a reduction in the risk of intraventricular hemorrhage, necrotizing enterocolitis, and overall the respiratory outcome is much better. So they recommended that antenatal corticosteroids should be administered to all women at risk of preterm labor between 24 and 34 weeks. And this was again endorsed by several other academies. So again, going into a little bit on the details, who are the candidates? So the good clinical practice recommended that all women between 24 and 34 weeks of gestation should be given offered corticosteroids. But the important thing is to remember here is it is for those group of women who are at risk of preterm birth within 7 days. In my next few minutes, I'm going to a little bit elaborate on how corticosteroids are misused and, you know, we are pumping corticosteroids into so many women where there is no clear-cut indication. So what we need to remember here is it needs to be a clear-cut risk of preterm birth within the next 7 days. That is the best time to consider. What are the consideration points? It is, again, a decision which you are going to use based on inputs with the family and the limitations of the setup that you're working in. So when you decide that it is 24 to 34, this is not written in stone, there will be a group of women who are between 24 and 27 weeks. Now this is the gestation in which you want to actually give a intact survival. You just don't want the baby to survive. You want the baby to be healthy, to have no residual neurological deficit, to have no cognitive dysfunction. You want this child to be an intact newborn. And therefore, when you decide that you want to give a corticosteroid to a pregnancy between 24 and 27 weeks, it is very, very important to take decision of the family into consideration, and they need to be told about what would be your end point, what kind of a child would you be handing over to this family. Do not make this decision unilaterally. So I'm going to go into the details of what happens to the women between 28 and 34, which is there is really little controversy about them. Again, it is the late preterm between 34 and 36 weeks. These are the late preterms. Here we have to balance out the risk and the benefit of giving corticosteroids, and also talk about those in which the corticosteroids may be offered after 37 weeks. So here again, animal and human studies are there, and a little bit of risks and benefits I'm going to talk about. So I found this beautiful study of maternal fetal medicine unit in the United States, which conducted a very, very large double-blind placebo-controlled randomized clinical trial in late preterm labor patients, and they evaluated whether the use of antenatal corticosteroids, especially betamethasone, for pregnant women at risk, high risk of late preterm, that is 34 to 36 weeks, and they included those presenting with PPROM, that is premature rupture of preterm premature rupture of membranes, or those who had a planned delivery at late preterm for whatever medical indications, you know, severe preeclampsia, severe heart disease, severe uncontrolled diabetes, and you need to deliver, whether it is beneficial to give corticosteroids at this stage. And the study found that betamethasone led to a significant decrease in the need for respiratory support and reduced respiratory complications, thereby reducing the rates of TTNP, bronchopulmonary dysplasia, and postnatal surfactant. So this is a very important, recommendation that and finding that they made, and which was then taken into consideration when the guidelines were formulated, that betamethasone does have a significant benefit for women even between 34 and 36 weeks of gestation who are likely to have preterm delivery in the next 7 days. Infants, and they also recommended, and they also found in their studies that infants exposed to betamethasone were less likely to require immediate postnatal resuscitation. And they also found a very significant thing that there is no increase in the risk, proven risk of neonatal sepsis, chorioamnionitis, or endometritis with late, endometritis with late betamethasone. What they did find, however, that hypoglycemia is more common, but it is not of such a significant drop in blood sugar that the length of hospital stay for these children is impacted. Important considerations specific for late preterm corticosteroids. Important consideration is we should not be giving them to any women diagnosed already with the clinical chorioamnionitis, because here you might worsen the chorioamnionitis and it will put the woman's life at danger. Tocolytics should not be used in an attempt to delay delivery in order to give corticosteroids. So for example, if you have for any indication like, you can delay for 2 days by giving tocolytics, but she's already 34, between 34 and 36 weeks. It doesn't make any sense. There is no medical reason to delay a delivery just to give steroids beyond 34 weeks. And indicated preterm labor, for example, if there's a maternal complication and it's getting worse, do not delay the delivery just to give corticosteroids beyond 34 weeks. Another very interesting fact, this is very important. Again, we talk about between 34 and 37 weeks. We all know that fetal maturity is complete at starts at 37 weeks, lung maturity. And many a times when we have a planned C-section, we are very casual in giving out the dates. This is especially in a person who is already of a C, who already has a previous C-section, and you want to now plan her date of delivery. And in India, it is very common to go for Muhurat deliveries. Here we give it to pressure that as long as the delivery date is chosen anytime after 37 weeks, it really doesn't matter. But what was a very interesting fact which was found in this study, in this maternal fetal medicine unit, was that before 39 weeks, if you deliver planned C-sections, the probability of having some amount of fetal lung immaturity is still there. And therefore, if you have a choice of taking a planned C-section and there is no risk to the mother or the child, try to push on these deliveries to as late as 39 weeks. And also what it was also found, which we all know, is that before 39 weeks, if the woman delivers, if she was a little bit in labor or, the stress of labor actually helps the infant as far as the respiratory outcome is concerned. Now, in general, when we give corticosteroids antenatally, what is the best dose? Again, there's a big controversy between betamethasone, dexamethasone, and generally the whole point is around, we need to give around 24 milligrams in a span of 24 hours. If you give betamethasone, the recommended dose is as is in your screen. And if you do not have dexamethasone or betamethasone, hydrocortisone is a backup which is available even in small centers like PHCs. But the difference between, a lot of controversy. So a lot of clinicians will wonder whether this is better. Some years back, dexamethasone was more popular, then betamethasone became more popular. What is the difference? So there is only a methyl group difference between dexamethasone and betamethasone. There are some benefits of betamethasone and some benefits of dexamethasone. And there was a very recent 2015 study by WHO, which showed and it concluded that there is no added advantage of one over the other. So both of them have very minimal mineralocorticoid action. Both of them have very little immunosuppressive action. And therefore, they can be both given. The difference is betamethasone has a longer half-life. So the clearance from the body is slower. Dexamethasone is more easily available. It is more inexpensive in a country like India. It is, cost does matter. Here, I would like to emphasize on one thing to my fellow obstetricians is that you need to document when you transfer a mother out after giving steroids. Because very often when the mother is transferred from one center to the next to a better center, the documentation is not given, and the type of steroid which was given, the dose which was given, the timing which was given, this leads to a confusion whether the dose should be repeated or not. So there is a big concern about maternal harm, fetal harm, and then you have to balance out risk and benefit. And when you do not have proper records, you don't know what to do. So the studies, the good clinical practice recommendation included that multiple courses are not recommended. National Institute of Child Health and Human Development in 2000 consensus panel also noted that although the respiratory outcome of the fetus will be better when there is a repeated course, but there is also a suggestion with animal and human studies that it will also have some deleterious effect on the fetus regarding cerebral myelination and lung growth and the function of the hypothalamo-pituitary adrenal axis of the fetus. So regularly scheduled repeated courses or serial courses more than two is currently not recommended. Because for treatment with corticosteroids for less than, because treatment, but what is also recommended is that even if you have the delivery imminent in less than 24 hours, you have a time of say 8 hours, 12 hours, even single dose of corticosteroid, because it does have a significant reduction in neonatal morbidity and mortality, a single dose of a corticosteroid, even if you have no time to finish the course, can still be recommended unless the delivery is immediately anticipated. So there is a recommendation of a single rescue course. Many of us are always wondering that what to do when the corticosteroid has been given and the pregnancy is prolonged. So it's very clear cut. The recommendations are that if the delivery has not occurred within 7 days, but the gestation is less than 34 weeks, and you have an imminent delivery within the next 7 days. This is very important to remember all the 3 points. That the delivery did not occur within 7 days, the woman is less than 34 weeks, and there is a risk of preterm birth again within the next 7 days, and your prior course was at least 14 days previously. Only then it makes sense to give a repeat course. So for example, if you have given a course of corticosteroids and the delivery has prolonged to 8 days, 9 days, but now you feel in the next 2 or 3 days the delivery is going to happen, then you should repeat. Or if your delivery is, you feel that it is going to prolong for another few days, it is not recommended that you give, unless you feel that this patient is going to deliver in the next few, within the next 7 days. What about the recommendation in multiple gestations? Unless there is a contraindication, a single course of antenatal corticosteroids should be administered to all women in 24 to 34 weeks only if there is a risk of preterm delivery within 7 days. Why did I specially bring this up? Is a lot of our IVF friends, you know, when they refer back after the IVF has taken place, and many of them are multiple gestation, back to the, you know, obstetrician, they will write a chart in which they are mentioning what are the tests to be done in a timeline. And at 28 weeks, there is always a recommendation, give a dose of corticosteroid. Now, it is not recommended. It is not recommended as a prophylactic for all patients. It is recommended to be given only if you feel there is a possibility of a preterm delivery in the next 7 days. It's not recommended to give, again, I'm emphasizing, as a prophylactic at routine 28 weeks. Women with diabetes, basically. So, you know, we get a lot of women, almost one third of our pregnant women are now diabetic. And this, we do know that corticosteroids can increase your blood sugar levels. So we are always scared whether in diabetic women should we give corticosteroids or not. But it is recommended that diabetes is not a contraindication. What you just need to do is a little closer monitoring, maybe up the dose of insulin. And definitely, as per protocol, you can, even with pre-gestational, gestational diabetes, corticosteroids, if indicated for obstetric reasons, should not be withheld from diabetic mothers. Here again, there's a small controversy about fetal growth restriction, because some studies did find that giving corticosteroids to fetal growth restricted babies will actually reduce their growth, though there will be some lung maturity, there will be some reduction in the growth, head size, and fetal growth will be retarded. So this holds true only for multiple doses, multiple courses. In general, it is recommended that it significantly reduces the incidence of respiratory distress syndrome, intraventricular hemorrhage, prenatal deaths, and therefore most trials, most cohort, large cohort studies have revealed that it is beneficial to give corticosteroids even with fetal growth restriction. What about in preterm PROM? Again, here the worry is that when you give steroids, the chance of the maternal infections would increase. But what is recommended that between 30 and 32 weeks, in the absence of clinical chorioamnionitis, it is definitely indicated, because otherwise the preterm child would have a high risk of not only respiratory distress syndrome, but IVH also. Beyond 32 weeks, it is an individual decision based on conversations with your patient, based on your personal experience, based on your conversations with your neonatologist. You should decide whether you need to give steroids to a PPROM person. What are the long-term outcomes, risks, and additional considerations when you give? So concern is that they may potentially affect neurodevelopmental issues in the child, but this is based mainly on animal data, and the maternal fetal medicine units clearly stated that adverse aspects or adverse outcomes of repeated courses are only when there are at least four or more courses. And there also they found that some amount of cerebral palsy is associated when a woman is given more than four courses of steroids. So what we do know is that corticosteroids is a rare example of a kind of a technology which at a very low cost, it gives a substantial cost saving. There are definitely, gray areas. There are certain areas where, you have to weigh out the benefit and the risk. But in general, it is one of the rare examples in which that when you have an imminent delivery in the next 2 to 7 days, the benefits are definitely outweighing the risks. Thank you so much all for a patient hearing. And I now hand over the session back to Dr. Sridhar. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. It was a lucid presentation, very fluent and very practically oriented. So I like the way you addressed important concerns like the multiple pregnancy, the documentation, and these are areas where everyone needs to focus on, and someone working in a referral center pointing out these areas definitely helps the colleagues in the community. So really appreciate your taking up these points. So it's very interesting if you look at the history of antenatal steroids, how Liggins and Hovey's study was published in 1972. But as you rightly said, it took us till the late 1980s to routinely implement, even though the Cochrane review that was done at that stage showed a clear cut. And that is the impetus for the Cochrane collaboration and the evidence-based medicine as we practice it nowadays. So hopefully now we don't have that much delay in implementing important findings. So we'll have a general question session towards the end, but I have a couple of points I would like you to address before we go on to Dr. Om Prakash to come in. One is, you mentioned not to give prophylactically in many situations, and prediction of preterm labor is obviously a challenging topic, isn't it? So, I mean, fetal fibronectin, the scan for the cervical length, and nothing is clear cut. So some obstetricians believe in aggressively giving just for the sake of giving it, because you can't be clear cut in predicting it. So can you give tips as to how the colleague can decide whether you need to think of it at that stage? What are the main factors you look for?
So definitely, this is, one is that you look at the history. So if you are looking at a singleton gestation, you're looking at her previous obstetric history, if you have it. If she has a history of a previous preterm delivery, if during your routine scans and a good fetal medicine specialist has done and her cervical length is not looking very good, or if she has repeated urinary infections or repeated vaginal infections. Now, these are clinical judgments where you might think that she could possibly go into preterm labor. But in a multiple gestation, the main concern is basically in multiple gestations, where we know that almost 65% of multiple gestations may end up in preterm labor. The concern raised by many of the committees was, and that's a concern that probably even I would think, is giving it randomly based on just the fact that I'm looking at just the fact that she had a twin delivery and it's an IVF precious pregnancy. I would not recommend that you give steroids at 28 weeks, because we don't know what is going to happen next. See, when I mentioned in my talk that serial courses are not recommended, okay? Though they have said that, you can have a single rescue course nobody's recommending more than two courses. Now you don't know what's going to happen at 30 weeks, or you don't know what is going to happen at 32 weeks. So giving her, putting her to take the risk of a steroid at 28 weeks without really having any clinical data to support it is definitely not recommended. What if at 32 weeks she needs, and then you need to repeat a course at 34 weeks again? So you've already given her three courses. So it would not be recommended routinely without having clear cut, clinical implications.
That's great. I mean, I think many colleagues in India are watching it, and all of you would be familiar with the story in Mahabharata where Karna has a curse that he can use the Brahmastra only once. So you have to choose it rightly. Here we have one more opportunity. You can use it if under 32 weeks and you have given more than 14 days ago. But repeated courses are certainly not to be recommended. So think carefully before you give the first course and don't use it prophylactically. So the other point is, in your practice, are you using it in the late preterm and in the early term, such as elective deliveries, for example?
So we were not really recommending, not really, I'll be very honest with you, I was not really using it more beyond 34 weeks. Okay, not really beyond 34 weeks. But the interesting thing is, when I started researching, when I was preparing for this webinar, and I was very happy to read that, and we were using it only for very, very small niche group of patients, maybe we are also seeing that this child is underweight, or she's had a previous pregnancy loss and we are very concerned about that, or she's a diabetic. Now you will be surprised to know that why in a diabetic, because their lung maturity is even more delayed than in a normal non-diabetic mother. But after I was doing research for this, I realized that I should not be holding myself back when I feel that 34 to 36 weeks is going to benefit. But we are very lucky that we have a very good NICU team. So I have Om Prakash with me, so I'm not worried. I hand him a baby at 34 weeks, I know for sure he's going to give me back a healthy, intact, survival child. But maybe since I'm sitting on a platform where I'm probably reaching out to people who do not have the luxury of a very good tertiary care center to practice, and you're not very sure if your NICU local facility is very good, and you don't have even a facility to transfer out this woman or the baby, then it is strongly recommended that 34, 36 weeks you should, because that's what all good clinical practices and Cochrane data is supporting that.
And I would like to point out here that even though the ALP study had shown the hypoglycemia, these are a group of babies where anyway you would be monitoring them for sugar monitoring and supporting their feeding. And some of them may be in the NICU actually during that period. So that shouldn't deter us. And obviously in the term babies, it's an individual choice. Elective deliveries before 39 weeks, as you rightly said, shouldn't happen if at all we can prevent it. But if you do decide to do it, maybe we can give the parents the choice. And the number needed to treat depends on the gestation, isn't it? So from 37 weeks, you gain more, but 38 weeks, you gain a little less, and 39 weeks, probably you don't need to use it. So you can individualize, and probably if you have diabetes or other complications, you can gear towards giving it. So with this, I would request the audience to input your questions in the question session, and Dr. Vandana will be with us. I hope you're okay to stay with us till the end, Dr. Vandana.
Yes, of course.
So she'll be with us once we finish Dr. Om Prakash talk. We'll go through the questions. I think one of their team will be looking at the questions and selecting which ones will be projected, and we will then look into it. So thank you so much for an excellent talk and great discussion at the first stage, but we have picture abhi baki hai dost. So with that, I would like to invite our next speaker, who is going to talk on a very challenging topic for all neonatologists, Dr. Om Prakash. Many of you may be knowing him. So he did his MBBS in GS Seth Medical College, and he did his post-graduation in Aurangabad Government Medical College. Subsequently, he moved to UK, where he did his membership, and he worked in London, as well as he got a fellowship in neonatology there. He has returned to India, which would be a big passion, and I wish I could have come back and joined you there. But working in your home country is obviously the most important thing we can do, and well done for coming back and supporting the families. And Dr. Vandana has a glowing reference for you. So today we will be discussing postnatal steroids, where we are, and I know this is a very complicated topic where there is no clear answer for anyone. You have to individualize, and obviously he's going to give us tips on what to use, when to use, and hopefully we'll have a very good discussion in the end. So over to you, Dr. Om Prakash.
Dr. Sridhar. So after an interesting talk by Madam on antenatal steroids, we are going to discuss about the postnatal steroids, where we are. So I was discussing with Madam in the morning, and then, you know, antenatal steroids is like you do it, and postnatal steroids is still to do or not to do. So this is the place where I'm trained, and this is the place where I'm working at present. So steroids in general are fast catching up with antibiotics as most abused class of drugs. Initially in neonatology, they were introduced with a lot of enthusiasm, but over a period of time, as we realize there are a lot of side effects associated with the steroids, we are very cautious when we are using and what doses we are using. So we discussed briefly about Cochrane logos, you know. So I will say the Cochrane logo was delivered because of the antenatal steroids. So you can see the first RCT was done in 1970, and it took almost like 1919 to 2000 for the practices to change, and that is the reason the meta-analysis has started. So in my presentation also, I'll try to focus on the different meta-analysis in terms of use of postnatal steroids that we have got available up till date. So generally the neonatal story starts with the admissions in the NICU. So I'll be going with a case-based discussion. One of my professor used to see, tell us like a CBD, like case-based discussion, and where he says, the C is the choices and BD is the segment, like B is the birth of the baby and death is, you know, disabilities and death of the baby. So the choices that you make during the neonatal time in the intensive care that decide the length of the segment of this BD segment, and that decides the outcome of this segment also. It's not just the survival what we want an intact survival. So I'm going to discuss a case that we managed. So this baby was born by emergency section at 28 weeks, 750 grammar meal, born to a primary, couldn't get much of opportunity to give antenatal steroids because there was a decreased fetal movement and mother has got a leaking PV for 24 hours. So immediately after birth, baby did require support in terms of a CPAP. There was a grunting, the oxygen requirement was quite significant. So we have to electively intubate and give surfactant because there was no antenatal steroids for this one. Generally, we practice ensure like intubate, give surfactant and extubate. But in this situation, the oxygen requirement was quite significant. So we continued ventilatory support for the baby and transport to the NICU. Baby did require second dose of surfactant also. This was the first X-ray, which shows the typical appearance of a RDS lungs, where we can see the whiteout or red reticular ganglion pattern of the lung with air bronchogram. ET tube is in place. Now, we were trying to wean the ventilation, but it was quite difficult to decrease the ventilation for this baby. The oxygen requirement was persistently high, as well as the settings were also persistently high. So we looked at the contributing factors, and duct, as we know, most of the times that does contribute for this. And this baby has got a hemodynamically significant PDA, which required a course of paracetamol. So we give paracetamol in our unit, and we are happy with that. In a situation, if paracetamol doesn't help, we use the other medications. So after review echo, the duct has, you know, decreased in size significantly, but still the ventilatory requirement was significant. The initial sepsis screen was negative, but still at the end of 1 week, we are not able to wean ventilation. We repeated certain sepsis screen as well as we did the chest X-ray of this baby. So the X-ray you can see, so there are certain features which tells us that the RDS has turned into a different way. So this is a chronic lung disease picture. So we generally, whenever we see within a week of time, we try to, you know, systematically analyze the X-rays to see whether this baby is going to have a high risk for development of chronic lung disease. In fact, these are all changes of a early BPD. So we look at the fibrosis based on the interstitial shadows. We convert, you know, split the lung into four quadrants, and based on the areas of fibrosis, we give one score to each quadrant. We look at the cyst. So in this X-ray, we can see there are small as well as large and multiple cysts are there. So we got a score of 2 here, and look at the expansion of the lung. If there are hyperinflated lung, that means you are finding difficult to you know, ventilate the baby. So you are trying to increase your pressure, PEEP particularly, that causes hyper expansion of the lungs. So this baby's score was coming somewhere around 7. So that tells that this baby is at a high risk of development of chronic lung disease over a period of time. Another way of analyzing the risk calculator for the BPD development is this NISH calculator. So here we put the data in terms of the gestational age, the weight of the baby, sex of the baby, ethnicity, the postnatal day of life, and the ventilatory requirement in terms of the IMV or SIMV mode of ventilation and the oxygen requirement. To save time, I have put the values already in the system, and this will tell us how much is the risk of death, risk of development of severe BPD, risk of development of moderate to mild BPD. So for this baby on day 7 of life, there's a 21% chances that this baby may die over a period of time. There is 23% chances that baby will develop a severe BPD, 32% chances that baby have got a moderate BPD, and 19% for development of mild BPD. So based on this available information, based on the criteria on the X-rays and this NICHD BPD calculator, this baby is at a very high risk of development of BPD. So here comes why this baby has developed such kind of lungs. So the contributing factors for development of chronic lung disease are antenatal as well as the postnatal. So antenatal steroids are helpful for prevention, and you know, in fact, they help improve the respiratory outcomes, the neurological outcomes, but at the same time, they do compromise the growth of the lungs. So chorioamnionitis is the second factor, intrauterine growth factor, growth retardation, and genetic susceptibility. All these factors contribute to the development of early BPD or new BPD. And the postnatal factors, which again increases the risk of development of BPD, are ventilation-induced lung injury. That is the reason we are trying to do minimally invasive ventilation, like a CPAP. Even the surfactant that we are trying to do nowadays, we are changing to the mist therapy. Second is the oxidative stress. So we have to make sure that we are targeting saturation between 90 to 95%. Not good to have 100% saturation for the baby from the delivery room itself. So we need to be very careful with the oxygen that we are using for these babies. Third is the infections, steroids, and pulmonary fluid overload, and nutritional deficits. So all these factors contribute significantly to the structural lung injuries, and over a period of time, it develops into the bronchopulmonary dysplasias. Postnatal steroids. I'm going to try to address on this topic particularly. There are other factors which are contributing factors that we already discussed, but I'll focus more on the steroids. So why we use steroid? Which is the better steroid, when to use, at what doses, and different routes of use of steroids postnatally. So steroids, as we know, you know, at present we are, you know, tackling COVID storm. So this similar sort of storm happens in babies who are going to develop the chronic lung disease. So steroids help to decrease this storm by decreasing the inflammation. They decrease the polymorphic nucleus cell infiltrates, decreases the production of elastase, prostaglandins, leukotrienes, TNF-alpha, and interleukins, as well as they help to decrease the pulmonary edema. I hope this slide is clear, because the second factor is that they decrease the pulmonary edema by decreasing the vascular permeabilities by doing membrane stabilization. They do help to induce bronchodilatation by upgrading the beta adrenergic activity. Also, they are helpful for induction of surfactant synthesis, and they have got a role in PDA closure. So all this helps to improve the lung compliance and decrease the airway resistance. And as a result of that, we can try to wean the baby on the ventilation, and over a period of time, we can extubate the baby from ventilator to the non-invasive mode of ventilation. So this is how steroids help. They have got anti-inflammatory properties, they decrease pulmonary edema, they do cause bronchodilatation, promote surfactant production, and improve lung compliance and decrease resistance. So that is the reason we use steroids in prevention and treatment of bronchopulmonary dysplasias. Now, which steroid? So there are hydrocortisone, fluticasone, dexamethasone, high dose, low dose. Different varieties have been tried and tested. So this is one of the way of doing meta-analysis. So here, the circle size reflect the number of participants. The line widths reflect the number of direct comparisons between the studies. And there are no connections between hydrocortisone and low-dose dexamethasone, that tells that the treatments didn't be a direct comparison between these two studies. So if you see this diagram, so maximum number of studies are about low-dose dexamethasone and the placebos in comparison to the high-dose dexamethasone. Even if you see the hydrocortisone, fluticasone, the numbers are not so high. So that tells us indirectly that there was some correlation that low-dose dexamethasone is more helpful. That is the reason more and more studies, they wanted to look into low-dose dexamethasone and placebo-controlled trials to look at the efficacy of steroids in the postnatal prevention of chronic lung disease. So I'll be talking about two trials, you know, which are very good trials to start with. One is this Primilog trial and second is the DART trial. So in this trial, they use low-dose hydrocortisone, which is like 1 milligram per kg every 12 hourly for 7 days, followed by 0.5 milligram per kg per day for 3 days. So they showed that there is significantly increased survival without BPDs for in the babies where they use low-dose hydrocortisone. At the same time, they noted there is a significant higher risk of sepsis. So steroids, yes, they do help to decrease the inflammation, but at the same time, they do have what an immunosuppression effect. And preterm babies, as we know, they are most delicate. So there is a very high risk of sepsis. So we need to be very careful when we are giving them the steroids. This trial was stopped because of the funding issues. So we couldn't get the complete data, but however, this showed us that low-dose hydrocortisone is helpful for prevention and treatment of bronchopulmonary dysplasias. Second trial, which many of the units use, is the DART study, which is like dexamethasone, a randomized trial. Here, they could recruit 70 babies, but as the information coming up about the risk of neurodevelopmental disabilities because of the role of steroids used postnatally, they found difficult to recruit the number of babies. So they could recruit only 70 babies, and they showed that the risk of development of BPD in these babies quite less. So the only proper conclusion that should be drawn is that no conclusion can be drawn from this study. However, in practices, we do use the doses of dexamethasone that they are used in DAS study. Now, when to start? Early treatment, that is within 7 days, moderately early treatment is 7 to 14 days, and delayed treatment is 2 weeks. Now, early treatment, here we are using the medicine before the storm starts. Okay, so it is good to prevent the storm and the consequences of this inflammatory storm that happens in the preterm babies. Now, this inflammatory storm has got an effect not only on the lungs, but has got an effect on the brain also. You know, so it is said like if you ventilate the baby for a longer time, that has got a long-term consequences of ventilation induced lung injuries, as well as the episodes of hypoxias, as well as this inflammatory storm affecting your lung and brain. So we have to take a choice whether to ventilate for a long time or whether to use steroids, which maybe have got some side effect, but we can decrease the ventilatory support, extubate, and can have some neurological deficit or neurological problems in long term because of the steroids. So this making choice is difficult. So early steroids within 7 days, the risk of having neurological problems was high. So we are very cautious to use early steroids. So moderately early and late. So moderately early is a good time frame to think of starting the steroids, because delayed steroids is like already storm has happened and the consequences of storm has already happened, and it may not help a lot in terms of having a good the respiratory outcome also if you are using late steroids. So better to use it somewhere between 7 to 14 days. Now, early postnatal steroids, a good meta-analysis is available on Cochrane, which tells us it does help for early extubation, it does decrease the BPD, but at the same time, it has got an increased risk of death, increased risk of sepsis, GIB, GI perforation, hypertension, and hyperglycemias, and long-term has got a neurological problems and even cerebral palsy. So it's better not to use steroids early within 7 days of life for prevention of development of BPD. So why do steroids have got an effect on the deteriorating effect on the brain? So it does decreases the cerebral cortical gray matter volume. This was based on the MRI findings. So as a result, the head circumference is decreased, as well as it impairs the neuronal proliferation and maturation. And we know the plasticity of the neonatal brain. So at the stage of growth, if there is a suppression of the myelination and the growth of the neurons, then this will be having a long-term consequences. That is the reason babies, extreme preterm babies, you know, sometimes they do have what a subtle neurological problems like behavioral disturbances and all that thing. May not be typical cerebral palsy, but they do have what behavioral disturbances if they have received antenatals as well as the postnatal steroids. So possible effect is, one is the apoptosis. They do inhibit the growth factor and they facilitate apoptosis. They have what an effect on the NMDA glutamate receptors that lead to neuronal cell death following the release of glutamate. That may be the reason that steroids have got a deteriorating effect on the brain development and leading to the consequences of delayed development and cerebral palsy. Now, late postnatal steroids, we saw the experience of early steroid, there is a high chances of neurological problems, so we should avoid. And the meta-analysis showed that dexamethasone was commonly used in most of the studies. And as I discussed already, 7 to 14 days is a better time frame for using the late steroids rather than using it too late. This is again the meta-analysis by Doyles et al. From Cochrane. So this shows very clearly that, so again, just to briefly explain, so this is your confidence interval and this square represent the number of participants in the study. So if you see this meta-analysis of the studies, the diamond is on the left side, which tells that the outcome is better with steroids than not to use steroids. So risk of BPD is decreased for babies where the steroids have been used postnatally after 7 days. Similarly, the risk of death is also very clearly decreased. You can see on this chart also. So all the meta-analysis favors, but at the same time, I want you to keep a track on the number of, number of babies in all these studies. So this third chart depicts that about the neurological outcome. So again, the diamond is more towards the left. Yes, it is crossing a bit to the line, but still the effect, the positive effect is more in comparison to negative effect. So late steroids have got a less mental disability in comparison to early steroids. And the risk of cerebral palsy is also less in comparison to the early steroids. So to summarize, late postnatal steroids have got a benefits for early extubation. They do decrease the chances of development of BPDs and death. They reduce need of home oxygen. So home oxygen is something which is sometimes difficult in our Indian scenario, but in Western world, they use home oxygen very routinely. So they found it challenging to manage home oxygen in given scenario. So home oxygen requirement is also required for baby. The need of home oxygen is less for the babies who received the late postnatal steroids. However, a word of caution, there is a risk of sepsis, which we need to keep a close watch on. Severe ROP is one more factor that we know that antenatal steroids have got a lot of positive effects on all these developments, but postnatal steroid neutrality have got a bad effect on the development of the eyes. There is also associated risk of development of hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, hypertension, and hyperglycemia. So all the studies, they are not sufficiently powered. So no study was sufficiently powered to detect important long-term sensory outcome. Because as I showed, the number of babies included in all studies is hardly in three digits, like 400, 500 kind of thing. So based on that much of data, it's difficult to tell us that, you know, use postnatal late steroid as a routine for prevention and treatment of bronchopulmonary dysplasias. So now dose of steroids, high dose or low dose. So high dose is like 0.5 milligram per kg per day. They may have got an advantage for BPD, but the side effect profile will be high. And in consideration with the neurological development, we are very cautious to avoid using higher doses of dexamethasone. As I mentioned earlier also, DAR study couldn't be completed because of the recruitment issues, but this study did help us to show the efficacy of this low doses of the dexamethasone that they use. So in our unit also, we use this low dose dexamethasone based on the 0.15 milligram per kg per day for 3 days, 0.1 milligram per kg per day for 3 days, 0.05 for 2 days, and 0.02 milligram per kg per day for next 2 days. So for the baby that I was discussing, it was difficult to extubate the baby to wean the ventilation. So we have to use this DART regime. So we used it for 10 days, and by the end of that we could manage to wean the ventilation and extubate the baby on the CPAP. So next is inhaled steroids. So we saw here that lot of side effects of the steroids was more because they are giving systemically, either they are giving IV or oral form. So to decrease the side effect profile, let's work on a more focused action of lungs only. So that was the principle why the inhaled steroids were entered in system. So early inhaled budesonide for the prevention of BPD, this was studies by Basil Est et al. This was one of the largest trial where he allocated 863 new units from the gestation of 23 weeks to 27 plus 6 days. Those babies who are on any sort of support, maybe ventilator or CPAP, within 12 hours of life were included in this study. He used budesonide 400 microgram every 12 hourly in first 14 days of life, and then dose was decreased to 200 microgram every 12 hours from day 15 onwards. And the drug was used till the baby was on the support of positive pressure or till postmenstrual day of 32 days. They used MDI, budesonide MDI with a spacer. So this study showed that out of 175 of 437 infants assigned to the budesonide group and 194 of 419 infants assigned to the placebo group, the incidence of BPD in the budesonide group was 27% and in the placebo group it was 38%, and death in the budesonide group was 16.9% and 13.6% in the placebo group. So if you see this, it looks like the risk of BPD has decreased in the inhaled steroid group. However, the risk of death is increased in the inhaled steroid group. So does that mean that inhaled steroids causes more death? They do help for the prevention of BPD. So I'm going to come to that further. So going with the same study, the long-term outcomes wise, the rate of neurodevelopmental disability of 2 years did not differ significantly between the infants who received early inhaled steroids and those who received placebo. So that means the risk of neurodevelopmental disability is less problematic with inhaled steroid. However, the mortality rate was higher among those who received budesonide. Now, based on this, we did the Cochrane did a meta-analysis where they have over 1,200 preterm babies. So here they felt that the effect on mortality could be due to chance, because nearly 43 babies lost to follow-up with unknown survival data, so which is a significant number. So inhaled steroid have a role in BPD. However, we need to select the babies very specifically. If the baby is selected at a very critical bad state, then obviously the outcome will be also bad. So that may be the reason that the mortality in the budesonide group is on a higher side in comparison to the control group. Now, next is using steroids with surfactant. So this is a study by Yeh et al., which was published in American Journal of Critical Care in 2016. Babies who are less than 1500 grams with RDS requiring ventilatory support with oxygen requirement of more than 50% were randomized to receive either surfactant alone or surfactant with 0.25 milligram per kg of budesonide every 8 hourly till baby is extubated or on oxygen of less than 30%. So the intervention group had a significantly lower incidence of BPD or death in comparison to the control group. So if you see, in addition to this BPD, they looked at the interleukin levels. So I was talking about the inflammatory storm. You know, we are aware of this COVID causing inflammatory storm in the lungs. So there is a role of steroids there also. So in postnatal steroids also, they looked at the interleukins in these babies. So the levels of interleukin 1, 6 and 8 in the tracheal aspirates were lower in the babies who have received the steroid along with the surfactant. And there was no additional significant neurological differences between the two groups at the mean age of 30 months. So that means steroids with surfactant are helpful for prevention and treatment of bronchopulmonary dysplasias. And this is the outcome of the study, which shows that the risk of death is less in the treatment intervention group in comparison to the control group, as well as the BPD, particularly the severe BPD, is also less in the intervention group than the control group. So the last policy statement given by American Association of Pediatrics that tells us that high dose dexamethasone doesn't seem to confer additional therapeutic benefit over low dose and is not recommended. Evidence is insufficient to make a recommendation regarding other glucocorticoids doses and preparations. There should be full informed consent of family regarding the potential short and long term risk of steroids. So this is very important medico-legally that we sit down with the parents when we feel that there is a need of steroids for that particular baby. We need to tell them the pros and cons, like being on the ventilator for a long time, that itself has got a long term outcome problems in terms of the neurological issues. And using steroids to help to remove the ventilation is a very important step. But at the same time, the steroids, they themselves may have got some effect on the brain. So this pros and cons of not using steroids and using steroid has to be explained to the parents very well. And a documented consent has to be taken before we think of using steroids. At the end, the AAP also says the clinician must use clinical judgment when attempting to balance the potential adverse effects of glucocorticoid treatment with those of BPD. So it is very important clinical decision also. That is the reason we try in our unit, we try to do the X-ray high risk and low risk criteria. We follow that criteria, as well as the calculator, BPD calculator, also help us to decide whether that baby is going to in a high risk of development of BPD. So take home message. There is a role of postnatal steroids in management of infants at risk of BPD. Early steroids are associated with decreased BPD but increased risk of cerebral palsy and poor neurological outcomes. Late steroids are associated with improved BPD. However, risk of abnormal neurodevelopment can't be ruled out. Stratification of risk of BPD can be used to determine infants that will benefit most from the steroids. Inhaled steroids can decrease BPD with no significant increase in mortality, needs more studies for neurological outcomes as well as the associated side effects of the steroids. And combining surfactant with budesonide, there are ongoing trials. The one what we saw by A et al. Does show that the surfactant with budesonide decreased BPD, as well as it has shown in the sheep model also that lung and brain inflammation is decreased with the combination of surfactant and budesonide. However, it needs more randomized controlled trials. So with this, you know, I'll stop my presentation. We are going to miss this part of the presentation due to the COVID-19. So these are some of the references, and the house is open for question. Dr. Gowdy is also with me, and
thank you. Thank you, Dr. Om Prakash, for a very nice presentation. You covered all the important aspects of postnatal steroid therapy and touched on some of the recent evidence that has come out, which may guide the physicians. Two important points. One is you started the first slide itself, you said about the abuse, and obviously two measures here. One is I think oxygen will beat both antibiotics and steroids in this queue. And luckily for us, there is a lot of awareness on oxygen toxicity right from the labor room onwards. So the NRP guidelines gives us the clear-cut saturation targets. There are more studies being done on the early oxygen use, as well as there is focus on the unit policies in terms of oxygen use. So that's one important area, both from BPD and ROP point of view, that we need to focus. And people are getting some kind of balance on looking at 90 to 95% as a reasonable saturation target after the boost and the support trial results. In terms of other medication that we should think about not abusing is the PPA and the antacid preparations. I mean, sometimes when people prescribe steroids, even though we are stringently avoiding the use of steroids, when we prescribe steroids, they tag on the PPA inhibitor or ranitidine injectable preparation has been taken out of most markets due to concerns. So I don't know if it's the same in India, but PPIs are also dangerous drugs, and obviously in a premature baby, there is increased risk of sepsis and NEC. So don't use such medications when you use a DART regime, because it's a low dose of steroid that we are using. Use it selectively for a very short period if at all there is definite sign. So that is in relation to this. And the very interesting point that comes out of the studies that we discussed, I mean, nowadays there is no role for prophylactic surfactant. And there was a study done in UK with the nitric oxide on a prophylactic basis to reduce BPD, and that did not show any benefit. The Bessler study is also, you can say, it's like a prophylactic use of inhaled steroids in a large group. You're starting right from day one, and you are trying to give a lot of babies a medicine that they may not be needing. So individualizing becomes very important when you talk of reducing side effects as well as showing a more positive outcome. Obviously, the Bessler study showed a positive outcome in terms of reducing BPD, but in terms of mortality, it left an open window. I'm sure the mortality rate in the initial publication, as you said, was not that bad. There was a slight tendency, but it was not significant. But at follow-up, 43 babies out of the 190-odd, it's a big number to lose. So that could explain the mortality. But at the same time, the choice of giving the steroid, the nebulized steroid, right from day one, or the inhaled steroid right from day one up to their needing oxygen or till 32 weeks is a really long period of exposure of even though inhaled or nebulized steroids are relatively safer, they're not going to be absolutely safe, because these babies have immature mucous membranes. I'm sure the absorption coefficient will be more in these babies than in bigger babies. So there will be a systemic effect of reasonable significance. So that is one area we should remember, that we can extrapolate some information from these studies, but we cannot. And the same reason why the prophylactic or early steroid use led to high CP rate, because you might be giving it in many more babies than they actually need it. So Doyle brought up this chart of how to assess the BPD risk and use it in those who are really at risk. And same way with the nebulized steroid as well, you can use the DART regime in the babies who are ventilated and you want to take them off the ventilator. And if they are stuck on NIV or CPAP or high flow, for example, you can use the nebulized steroid for a selective period of time. So in my practice, what I do is I pick up the babies when they're on CPAP extubated for a few weeks. If they're still not weaning, or if there is pulmonary hypertension on their heart scan, you don't want to keep aggravating the pulmonary hypertension. So you start nebulized steroid in this group of babies. I give 250 microgram twice a day for 5 to 7 days, and then I step down to 125. Again, in the Bessler study, they gave the high dose for 2 weeks, and then they reduce. So I give it for 5 to 7 days, and if they improve sooner, I step down fairly soon. And if they don't have an adequate response, I actually stop it, and sometimes we give a repeat trial. So it's a very difficult scenario. And recently in the archives, all of you might have seen, in this month's archive, there is a very interesting study on BPD with PPHN, their outcome beyond 36 weeks. So I would recommend all of you to read it, that once they reach 36 weeks, if the pulmonary hypertension is significant, there is a significant, about 30% risk of mortality. We have all had such babies, and we struggle with them despite using postnatal steroids in a late way. And so treat early. Don't let the pulmonary hypertension establish. Identify the babies, treat them early. If they have a PDA and you consider treating it, again, treat it early, because incident improvement or the response to steroid or PDA treatment is better if you give it right in the early stage. So don't give it to everyone. Choose your population carefully, but use it at the right time. So that would be my message. I think you have access to the questions from the audience. I don't have access to that. So can you select, and both of you can discuss one each, like one question each, and then move on with that.
I think there are no questions that I can see in the system.
That's very good. So we had a very nice discussion anyway. So do you have any comments? And Dr. Vandana, after listening to Dr. Om Prakash's talk, do you want to comment on the neonatal perspective?
What I do know is ki steroid, what I understood is steroids are a wonderful thing to give, but they every drug choice that we give to the child, we have to be very aware of the right time to give it and how much of benefit or harm it can do to your newborn. So yeah, we just cannot take this as a wonder drug for this thing, but we cannot even dismiss the use of it used properly. So it's a very interesting perspective, because postnatal corticosteroids is not something we even gave a thought to, all these years. It's interesting to hear that.
And since there are no questions, do you have any comments on antenatal steroids again, any afterthought or anything you want to add?
I think I pretty much covered it.
And Dr. Om Prakash?
It's a timely intervention that makes different outcomes. You know? That is what I would like to pass on to everyone. Delivery room CPAP is also a very important factor as far as the, you know, even the use of surfactant and ventilation is concerned in all these preterm babies.
So I think we had a great session. I mean, two excellent presentations. The speakers worked really hard and put together very comprehensive lectures. And I hope we can have this video available soon so we can leave it for the benefit of those who could not join us. I'm sure many of you are watching us, and we should thank the speakers for their great effort, and for Dr. Om Prakash for collaborating and making an excellent program like this. So we know that COVID has bad things, but linking up such connections is a great thing. And obviously, we really enjoyed being part of this. And I would like to thank you on behalf of the National Neonatology Forum UAE branch as well for giving us the opportunity to be part of this event, and to be familiarized with the people in Mumbai as well. And before we close, I would like to mention that I have my own YouTube channel. I've developed a passion for parent education. So I have created a YouTube channel with a number of interactive discussions with other specialists like gastroenterologists. And recently I've added the life support videos. So please review it. You can just find it as Sridhar K on YouTube search, and I hope you will benefit and share it with your patients as well. So with this, I would like to close the live meeting. I would request Dr. Om Prakash to initiate that from his end. Thank you. Appreciate your contributions.
Thank you, Dr.
Thank you. Yeah.